Okay, good morning. I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation to speak to you today on the management of eosinophilic esophagitis. Is this a food allergy or acid reflux? So the goal of my talk is to describe the rationale and practical approach for using PPIs and elimination diet therapies in the management of EOE. So what I thought I would try and do in the next 30 minutes is to review with you the current EOE management algorithm and highlighting the role of PPI therapy. Specifically, what is the rationale for using PPIs? What is the mechanism for PPI response? Defining patients who respond to PPI or PPI responsive esophageal eosinophilia, and is this actually a subset of EOE? Then we'll switch gears entirely and review the role of dietary therapy, the evidence for food antigen triggers in this disorder, the available options for dietary therapy, and then leave you with some practical tips for implementing dietary therapy in practice. So let's get started. So in 2017, the suggested algorithm for the management of EOE is if you have a patient with esophageal eosinophilia, you would treat them with a PPI for 8 weeks, followed by an endoscopy with biopsy. If their symptoms and histology normalizes, you would call them PPI responsive esophageal eosinophilia or possibly reflux. If they have over 15 eosinophils per high powered field, they're diagnosed with EOE. You would offer them treatment with either dietary therapy, possibly the 6-food elimination diet, or swallow topical corticosteroids, followed by an endoscopy with biopsy. If their symptoms and histology normalizes, they're in remission. At that point, if they were on the dietary therapy, you would go through the reintroduction process to identify food triggers and keep them on a maintenance diet, eliminating those triggers. If you started them on topical corticosteroids, you would reduce the dose of those steroids down and keep them on maintenance therapy. If, however, they had persistent symptoms and or pathology, you would rule out noncompliance, other allergies, or possibly persistent reflux. You may consider further elimination diet, changing your formulation of your topical corticosteroids, or esophageal dilation in those patients with esophageal strictures. So let's focus now on the PPI and dietary therapy and why they're so important in this algorithm. So what is the rationale for using PPIs? Well, one of the first studies to show the association of eosinophilia's response to PPI was by Dr. Noh and colleagues from Boston in a pediatric population. They had 3 young patients who had symptoms of EOE, food impaction and dysphagia. They were atopic and endoscopic features consistent with EOE. They treated them with PPI therapy, and they had high levels of eosinophils at baseline, all of which resolved after PPI treatment. Now, these researchers initially thought this association was due to eosinophils and reflux. However, they were probably the first to hit upon this topic of PPI-responsive esophageal eosinophilia. This entity was further defined by Dr. Molina Infante in Spain, who's really been leading this charge, in 35 adult patients who had high levels of eosinophils in their esophagus. They treated their patients with rabeprazole, 20 milligrams twice daily, and they found that their group, 75% of patients had improvement. 50% of those patients had an EOE profile, meaning they had endoscopic features consistent with EOE, and they were atopic. And interestingly, 30% of those patients had a normal pH study, suggesting that this was not just GERD mediated. Since that landmark study, there have been numerous studies since that time, both in children and adults, retrospective and prospective, that have shown similar results, with 35 to 74% of patients responding to PPI therapy. And this really laid the groundwork for the ACG diagnostic guidelines to necessitate the treatment of esophageal eosinophilia with high-dose PPI for 8 weeks, followed by a repeat endoscopy. So that leads us to the question, what are the mechanisms that the PPIs are working? Well, it's possible that patients have concomitant GERD. We know that in the adult population, up to 25% of our patients can have acid reflux. We know that based on studies from the 80s, that acid can cause low-level esophageal eosinophilia. So it could just all be reduction of esophageal acid. It could be that the PPIs are healing dilated intercellular spaces and improving barrier function. And we know that patients with EoE have this barrier dysfunction. And lastly, it could be that the medications themselves have anti-inflammatory properties, such as downregulation of important cytokines like eotaxin 3. And I'll go through each of these mechanisms individually. So here we have a schematic showing the association with reflux disease and esophageal eosinophilia. Here we see the squamous epithelium in the esophagus and the esophageal lumen. With acid exposure, that can cause significant inflammation in the epithelium, resulting in this dilated intercellular spaces and epithelial barrier injury. When that occurs, antigen exposure and food antigens can cross this barrier. Dendritic cells can take up that food antigen, present it to Th2 helper cells, which will then create a profound Th2 inflammatory cytokine cascade, which results in the endpoint of eosinophilic infiltration into the mucosa. If we stop this process up here in patients with high amounts of acid, we can prevent this downstream inflammation. The second scenario I told you about is that patients with EoE have an impaired barrier dysfunction. They've been shown to have decreased genes such as desmoglein 1 and filaggrin, which affect this barrier. So they could actually have more injury with even normal exposure to acid. So if we can prevent even normal amounts of acid here in these patients with barrier dysfunction, that can help with healing and prevent this downstream process. Lastly, I mentioned some anti-inflammatory properties of PPIs, and this was an elegant study done by Dr. Chang at UT Southwestern looking at two different cell lines. These are esophageal cell lines from patients with EoE. And she showed that there is downregulation of eotaxin 3 by omeprazole. Well, what does that mean? Eotaxin 3 is a very important cytokine that plays a role in trafficking of eosinophils to the esophagus. So what you can see here is that in normal states, there's no elevation of eotaxin 3 here on the y-axis. In response to pro-inflammatory cytokines, such as IL-13 and IL-4, there's a profound increase in the eotaxin 3, again, the thing that stimulates eosinophils. However, if you expose these cells to omeprazole, this response is significantly tempered, and this could explain this anti-inflammatory property, which is not necessarily reflux-mediated. So now that we know how PPIs work, can we define the patients who respond to PPI, or these PPI-responsive esophageal eosinophilia? Is this just a subset of EoE? Well, this is an area of very hot debate and research right now, and Dr. Molina Infante, whose data I showed you earlier, is really leading this charge. And he looked to see, if, based on baseline characteristic of his patients with EoE and PPI-RE, if there were any significant differences that could distinguish the two. So he looked at demographics and basically found that there was no difference in the two groups. He then looked at the presence of ATP, rhinitis, asthma, food allergy history, and found that there was no significant difference that could distinguish the two groups. Even symptom presentation was not enough to distinguish the two groups. They were virtually the same. Since this study, there have been other studies by Dr. Dellen at UNC that have shown similar results, that patients with PPI-RE have similar demographics, allergic history, and clinical presentation to patients with EoE. Well, what about endoscopic features? Can that distinguish the two groups? Well, here we see four different patients with characteristic endoscopic features of EoE. But what if I were to tell you that the first two patients had EoE and the second two patients had PPI-RE? Here we see their endoscopic features after PPI therapy, and you can see near resolution in patients with a PPI. In the PPI regroup. But what's important to note is that at baseline, they're virtually indistinguishable. So patients with PPI-RE have similar endoscopic findings as patients with EoE. What about histology? Clearly that can make a difference and can shed some light. Well, looking at eosinophil levels, even in the proximal and distal esophagus, there's no difference between EoE patients and PPI-RE. Looking at eosinophil byproducts, such as major basic protein, important cytokines like eotaxin 3, and mast cell hormones like tryptase, there's also no difference between EoE patients and PPI-RE, but they are certainly different than controls. And I talked to you about dilated intercellular spaces or barrier dysfunction, and you can see here all this white stuff around these cells. Those are the dilated intercellular spaces on these electron micrographs of patients with EoE and PPI-RE. After PPI therapy, these spaces persist in patients with EoE but do get better in patients with PPI-RE. But overall, patients with PPI-RE have similar symptoms, histologic findings as patients with EoE. Well, what if we were to dig a little deeper and look at the genotypic profile of these patients? Well, here you see a heat map of patients with EoE compared to normals and reflux. These are sophisticated studies done by Dr. Rothenberg's group and Dr. Wen at Cincinnati Children's. And what you can see here in this heat map is that blue genes are downregulated, red boxes are upregulated genes, and EoE patients have a very unique profile and genetic signature compared to reflux patients and controls. Well, how does this compare to PPI-RE? Well, looking here at the heat map, they're virtually identical. So hopefully what I've shown you up until this point is that patients with PPI-RE have similar clinical, endoscopic, histologic, and genotypic features as patients with EoE. So then it's very clear, right? All patients with PPI-RE have EoE. Well, it's a little bit more complicated than that because there's different scenarios of patients with esophageal eosinophilia who may respond to a PPI. For instance, you can have a patient here with classic symptoms of reflux, erosive esophagitis or Barrett's on endoscopy. Their eosinophilia on biopsy resolves with a PPI, and our clinical expertise would tell us this patient likely has reflux. In comparison to this patient, whose symptoms and endoscopic features are suggestive of EoE, their symptoms and pathology resolve with a PPI, and our clinical experience would tell us this is likely a subset of EoE. But certainly there can be some overlap in these patients, which leads to confusion. And if you think it's confusing, so do all these people in this room. So there was a day-long symposia prior to DDW this year with over 60 clinicians and researchers who all got together forming a working group on PPI-RE, or the AGREE conference. And basically what we agreed to do is agree to disagree on a lot of the features here, but we did agree that PPI therapy is very important in esophageal eosinophilia, and it may be shifting more in terms of being important as treatment as opposed to the diagnosis. But there will be a paper coming out here, and there will be more to come in the next 6 months. So I'd like to shift gears now and leave the PPI behind us and focus a little bit on dietary therapy. Specifically the evidence for food antigens triggering this disease. So the link to food antigens triggering EoE really started in the pediatric population, and studies using an elemental or amino acid-based formula, or a six food elimination diet, have been shown to be very effective at controlling histologic eosinophilia. And since these landmark studies, dietary therapy has really been the first line treatment of EoE in pediatrics. But it wasn't fully embraced or understood in adults until our study 5 years ago, who showed a six food elimination diet is highly effective at reducing symptoms, histology, and endoscopic changes in adult EoE. This was a prospective study of 50 adults who eliminated milk, wheat, soy, egg, nuts, and seafood for 6 weeks. And 70% of our patients had a peak eosinophil count less than 10 after just 6 weeks on the diet. Here are four of our patients with characteristic endoscopic features of EoE. After just 6 weeks on the diet, you can see dramatic improvement in their endoscopic features. And when we reintroduce back their trigger foods, you can see recurrence of their endoscopic features, sometimes even worsening than baseline, showing the association that food antigens were driving this. To further support this was the effect of food reintroduction on esophageal eosinophilia. So at baseline, our patients had elevated eosinophils, which normalized after the diet. After we added their trigger food, their eosinophil levels rose close to baseline again, really driving home the point that food allergens were driving this in adults similar to children. So now that we know the association with food antigens and EoE, what are the available options to pursue dietary therapy? Well, over the years, there have really been three modalities that have been developed. The elemental diet, which is a total elimination of all food allergens with an elemental or amino acid-based formula. Our targeted elimination, which is guided by allergy testing, typically skin prick testing or patch testing, or an empiric elimination diet, which is the removal of the most common EoE food triggers, milk, wheat, soy, egg, nuts, and seafood. So this is great. Which one should you pick, and is one better than another? So unfortunately, there have not been any head-to-head studies between these approaches. However, there's been a nice meta-analysis by Dr. Luis Sando in Spain, who has looked at the efficacy of all these approaches. The elemental diet is by far the most effective in about 91%. These studies all looked at the six food elimination diet and found the empiric elimination diet is 72% effective, so these are really the two best. And the targeted elimination diet really did not fare very well, only 45% effective. And these numbers are even lower in the adult studies. So this has really fallen out of favor and is no longer recommended. The problem with elemental diet, however, is it can be costly, and there's issues with palatability. So empiric elimination diet has really taken over as the mainstay of dietary therapy. But there are challenges with empiric elimination diet. Our goal of dietary therapy is not to take patients off of all these foods indefinitely, but to reintroduce the foods back and identify your food triggers. Unfortunately, right now, the only available way to do this is with a repeat endoscopy. And this is our algorithm here at Northwestern, which would require an endoscopy after several foods, approximately four. And some centers have protocols requiring up to 10 or 12 endoscopies. So can we streamline this a little bit better? Can we streamline which foods we're eliminating? So that goes to the question of what foods are the most common triggers. So our study, wheat and milk were the most common triggers, followed by soy and nut and egg just after that. Nobody was reacting to seafood. This is similar to the pediatric study where milk, wheat, soy, and egg were the most common. So it makes sense. Maybe let's streamline it down and do just a four food elimination diet. And that's exactly what was done. This is our adult study, single center prospective, eliminating milk, wheat, soy, and egg. The middle study by Dr. Kagawala is a pediatric multi-center study eliminating milk, wheat, soy, and egg. And the last study most recently published was by Dr. Molina in Spain, eliminating milk, wheat, barley, rye, oats, soy, egg, legumes, and peanuts. And what you can see in all of these studies is, although the efficacy does drop from your 72%, 75% with a six-food elimination diet, you still almost get half of your patients in remission. What about taking this a step further? So if you pool all the studies from the six-food elimination diet, one thing you will see is that most of the patients had just one food trigger, maybe two. And most common triggers, like I had just shown you, were milk and wheat. So can we hone this down even further to do a two-food? So this is was proposed by Dr. Molina and Lucendo in Spain, that maybe instead of doing a top-down therapy, meaning doing a six-food elimination diet, eliminating everything up front and then adding things back, maybe doing a step-up therapy. So starting with the two most common foods, and if you didn't respond to that, increasing it to the next two common foods, and then so on. So this is their data here. So what they did with the two-food elimination diet, their effectiveness was about 44%. In patients who didn't respond and went on to the four-food, it increased to 60%, and those that went on to the six-food, up to 80%, and this increase would be what you would expect. So again, it highlights that even with two foods, you can get about 40% of people in remission. So there may be some evidence to try and streamline our dietary therapy. So now that you know dietary therapy works, how can you implement it in implement this option in practice? And the biggest question our patients ask is, what can I eat? It's wheat-free, dairy-free, soy-free, nut-free, seafood-free, and egg-free. Enjoy your food. And many of our patients will look like this, very sad and blue, because they really like food. So it's not enough to tell them what they can't eat, but really provide them some resources with what they can eat. And this is a healthy menu on the six-food elimination diet and resources that we give our patients. So for instance, for breakfast, they can eat some breakfast sausage, a corn tortilla, rice and tapioca toast, and jam. For lunch, they can have vegetable soup, brown rice cracker, sun butter or avocado, banana sparkling water. For dinner, they can have roasted poultry, green beans, sweet potato with olive oil, rice or hemp milk, berries and lemon sorbet, and a whole bunch of snacks. So I don't know about you guys, but this is a heck of a lot healthier than what I eat in a typical day. And that leads to the question, can this diet be healthy? So it does meet USDA dietary guidelines for adults, with an emphasis on more plant-based foods such as fruits and vegetables, lean proteins such as poultry and pork, seed and heart-healthy fats such as olive oil and canola oil, alternative whole grains such as root vegetables and millet, and it's naturally low in processed foods. So if you believe in the food revolution or clean eating, this really fits nicely with that concept. So it's important when embarking on dietary therapy to remember the goal of dietary therapy is to assess if patients will respond to dietary elimination and to identify specific food triggers to help tailor the diet for long-term management. It's also to offer it as an alternative to swallow topical corticosteroids, to have the discussion with your patients that this option exists. If you were going to pursue this, obtain a dietary consultation early to assist with education and monitoring compliance. And make sure that your patients are strictly avoiding the foods for 6 weeks. If they call you 3 weeks into it and they say that they have fallen off the wagon and have gone out to eat and had some contamination, don't just continue to scope them at 6 weeks. They're likely to fail on the diet. Push that time frame back a little bit. So that leads to the question, what to do if your diet doesn't work after 6 weeks? I would assess for compliance and hidden sources of contamination. Make sure other confounders like reflux or allergens are being treated. Depending on the severity of the case, you can do empiric elimination of further dietary antigens. The next tier of common allergens is corn, beef, and legumes. You can change to medical therapy, to topical corticosteroids. In very rare cases, in really motivated patients, you can consider elemental formula, although that's not commonly done in adults. One of the things I mentioned to you was the difficulty with dietary therapy are the repeated endoscopies and these invasive procedures. But there is some hope on the horizon with some non-invasive testing for EoE. This is the esophageal string test, which is basically like a piece of dental floss housed in a little capsule developed by Dr. Faruda and Ackerman. You swallow this capsule down and the string soaks up eosinophilic byproducts, and it has shown to be good, well correlated with biopsy specimens. Unsedated transnasal endoscopy has been studied both in the US and in Australia and shown some good data there. As well as the cytosponge, which has been studied by Dr. Katzka. It's been used in the past for Barrett's and now being investigated as a non-invasive test for EoE. So these are potentially some modalities that can check the esophagus after food reintroduction. So in summary, regarding our current EoE management as it pertains to PPI and dietary therapy, PPIs can be helpful in the diagnosis and now the treatment of EoE. There are multiple mechanisms of response that are not just reflux mediated. Patients with PPI responsive esophageal eosinophilia, some of them may be a subset of EoE, and this is an area of active research. EoE is a food antigen driven disease, and offering dietary therapy as a viable alternative to topical corticosteroids is important. Your choice of diet should be individualized per patient, and a discussion needs to be made with your patients, but empiric elimination diet does have advantages over some of the other approaches. But I want to stress that no matter what treatment option you pick, whether or not it's topical corticosteroids or diet, maintenance therapy is very important in preventing fibrotic complications similar to an approach with IBD. So I would like to thank again the organizers for this invitation, our research and clinical group at Northwestern, our patients and our families who are the reason why we do what we do, and also all of you for your time and attention today. Thank you.